Yo, what's up? This is Del the Funkeé Homosapien. What's happening?
This is Kid Koala.
And we're Deltron 3030, and you're watching Toazted.
I'm here with the guys from Deltron 3030. How are you guys doing?
I'm doing cool.
Good, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Could you tell us why Dan isn't here?
Dan is recovering from a stomach virus or something.
He ate some crazy food.
Yeah.
He ate some bad food, or?
I think so. He wasn't doing well yesterday at all. He's resting, trying to get ready for the show tonight.
All right, you guys are back from 13 years ago, the last album. Why has it been so long?
Just trying to gather the fruits and berries, you feel me? To prepare the Smurf Berry Crunch. No, something like that, you know what I mean? Like, we had to just store up all the information to make such a ambitious record, you know what I mean? Like, it's a big deal. It's not just like any other rap record or any other musical project, you know? So all three of us had to work at what we was doing and try to bring everything to the table. And I would say for me, lyrically, is really what held it up probably the most.
Yeah, you're late?
It was hard to... I was working on it the whole time.
Yeah. He studied a lot, read a lot, and he's synthesizing a lot of the information before he... But it all sort of... When he kind of told us, he was sort of geared into, like, okay, it's time, I can do then too. I mean, we've been meeting about every couple of years since the first one, and we'd even have... You know, sketch up beats, and Dan would have beats, and I would have turntable parts where he sketched them, play him stuff, and we even recorded a few tracks, didn't we, that are not on this record. It was kind of the bridge record just to get the discussion going. So there's probably...
Is it ever going to be released? Or?
No, a lot of his lyrics were lost on a hard drive, actually.
Why? What happened?
I don't know, the hard drive just crashed, which wasn't a big deal for me because, like he said, that was like the preliminary work to get the feel of what we was trying to do anyway, so I didn't really care. I was like, okay, well, that's just an opportunity for me to make something new and make it better. We had already, you know, that was like practice. Like, I make a lot of songs, right?
Probably because you've done a lot of stuff in between, so.
Yeah. So I got like thousands of songs that nobody's ever going to hear probably except for like Eric and like people that's around me. But that's why, because it's like practice, you know what I mean? Like, no, that coming out? No, it's practice, you know? But once you hear something that comes out like majorly like this, you know we put in a lot of work. It's not just some throwaway something, you feel me? So that's why it took so long.
Yeah, because a lot of things happened in between. So you got the 9/11, you got the riots in Egypt, the bank collapses. It's all been like
breaking in my house, trying to take me to court. Yep.
Oh, also.
A lot of stuff happening.
Yeah, so I can imagine that's all influences for your lyrics.
Yeah, but probably not for Deltron. That one not for Deltron, probably. Made for my other lyrics, but like for Deltron, I tried to keep it a little bit more adventurous.
Yeah, but you speak on like issues that's okay. Oh, it's in the future, but yeah. It's still relevant for today.
Definitely, that was a main focal point too. Actually, less special effects and more on interpersonal relationships and even the politics that go on between people.
Yeah, because when I listened to the album and I really liked it, but. You have to really sit down for the lyrics because it's for me it was not like say your average top 40 rap song you hear with a simple chorus, but it's really deep.
Yeah, we weren't aiming for the chart spots. If we wanted to make a radio record, we would have. But I think when Del was discussing the type of story he wanted to tell, we pretty much treated it like it was a film or a graphic novel or something, and musically even. Dan and I had to think about it that way, how to create that musical score to the, you know, that bed of sound that would make sense and sort of augment what he's saying in his story. So that's how we always approached it. It was almost on a much more cinematic level. So it might even be one of those things where, okay,
sacrifice a hook or two on a couple of these songs, but when you thread it together over the course of the album, it actually ends up being like how it gets to the third act or something. Yeah. You know what I mean? And we thought about it that way, not so much about as just a series of singles or anything, you know?
I guess I could do that if I wanted to. It was boring, and that's not how.
Yeah, you've proven in the past that you could, so.
Yeah, of course I could do it, but like, put it this way. The reason why we have a structure like that is not because that structure was there in the first place. People like made songs the way they made them, and they happened to be like a dance hit if it was fast enough and groovy enough for people to dance to. You know what I'm saying? Or it might be like a ballad if it was somebody singing about a girl they like or whatever. You know, it was kind of slow. It was made for that type of environment. You know what I mean? So, like, somebody got the grand idea, like, okay, this is, people are more responsive to this song. So why don't we just siphon all this other stuff out? We'll just put this in there. That's the only thing that matters. We'll just center on this, you know? And then everybody that's in the industry is following that way. And then it gets, you know, gets to the point where you got it now, basically.
Aren't you afraid that sometimes the lyrics would go over the listener's head?
No, because like I said, like, you know, we're here now because somebody looked at the real and then diluted that.
Yeah.
So, like, I feel like people really want that real. You know, yeah. And any record, you're not gonna absorb a record in a few seconds. You know what I mean? I don't care if they say, okay, if a person don't like it in 30 seconds, then you lost them. That's not true. No. You know what I mean? Like, okay, if you don't, you could tell within 30 seconds if you're gonna dig the song or not. That's what they mean. But you're not gonna absorb anybody lyrics that quick. You know what I mean? So you're gonna have to listen to it a few times and maybe more and more times.
I think the best records you have to listen to lots of times before you really get the picture.
If you ever get it. Yeah. Everybody gonna have a different interpretation of it anyway. So do you really ever really get it? You form your own interpretation of it. So the more open the content is for you to be able to make your own picture out of it, the better. If it's all spelled out to you and hella simple and dumb, you know what I mean? Like, it's like, okay, it's over. And that's a lot of this disposable music that's out now. I'm not hating on it, but it's here today and gone the next day. And then you got to find somebody else to fill that place.
True.
It's not timeless. And I'm not saying ours is timeless. Like, you feel me? But, like, I tried to follow the greats. You know what I mean? I'm not even talking about rap music. I'm talking about, like, music. All the
Name someone.
Name someone, okay, Frank Zappa, since we on Lost Treasures and shit never coming out.
Right.
The hundreds of thousands of songs he had in his vault that's being released now, leaking out. You know?
You had some mixtapes before where you cut off Fela Kuti, P-Funk, and I also heard you want to do a third one.
Yeah, I was listening to some of it today.
Yeah.
Yep, and it's tight. I mean, I got enough to put out a record now, a mixtape now, so I'm probably going to release it pretty soon.
Oh, wow,
you
cool.
You said that, so now I'm like, okay, see, people know, don't you gotta put it out or else they go. Yeah. I mean, it's done, you know. I just kept going back trying to redo it because it's Frank Zappa. I didn't want to, you know what I mean? I kind of didn't even want to do it at a certain point because I'm like, okay. How would you feel if somebody took your compositions and chopped them up, minced him up, like, but I think Frank Zappa, if he was alive, he'd hear my shit and be like,
I guess.
Okay, that was tight, yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah, because he'd do it all himself. He even back in the day, he took his own records and said, okay. Yeah.
Once I seen that, I was like, okay, he was sampling before they was even calling it sampling. Like, he was the dude, actually, like, yeah.
Any favorites from him?
Huh?
Any favorite records?
Any favorites? Man, that leather one, Lava. That one is tight. The one that's like four albums long.
Yeah.
That one's pretty tight. What is it? Hot Rats.
Hot Rats, man. That's a dope
one. Yeah, that's probably one of my favorites. I like his first three too, Wearing It for the Money. What's the first one he came out with? With the
Freak.
Yeah. That's the one that I first seen and I was like, okay. Is he serious? You know, like the media always just made it look like he was a dummy or yeah, fool. So when I finally seen what he really was about, I was like, oh, okay, damn. Like, I see why it's a plot. You know what I'm saying? They wanted to try to make him look stupid or something because he was so deep. You know, he really wasn't that silly at all. Like, he was a satirist, basically. Yeah. So, like, I could see why people were trying to make it look like I don't listen to him because he was clowning people.
Do you guys think humor is lost in music nowadays? Because nowadays it seems to be it always has to be serious. And
no, I don't think that at all. I think people aren't very funny, but they're trying to be. Like, it seemed like every rapper is trying to have little punchlines and stuff, but they're just not sick enough to make it really funny.
Yeah, because coming back to the album, it has serious stuff in it, but the skits are all very funny, I must say. So do you think about it? There's like counter the heavier lyrics with like funnier skits?
Yeah, I mean, that was just sort of designed to be that palate cleanser. If we just hammered 14 sort of really heavy songs thematically, I think it would, yeah, people would like the record and then want to cut their face off right away. Or drive off the bridge or something. But so that is also still part of the story, you know. We just took, you know, for instance, from a chef's point of view, what his sort of idea would be in the future, or you know, with Lawn Chair Quarterback, was just to have that idea of the grumpy grandparents sitting on the porch, just, you know, pining for the golden era or the good old days, and where the whole world has sort of gone bad, you know what I mean? Since they remember, they're like, oh, I remember when life was so much easier or whatever, you know. And I think everyone feels that way sometimes about something separate, though.
I love it. Yeah. Right now, you know what I'm saying? This is tight. This is what I've been waiting for. I'm glad to be around to experience the Jetson age. You feel me? For real.
Yeah.
Like, it's tight to me. I spent hella time using the SB-1200 chopping up drum samples. Now I got a machine that do everything for me, put it on time stretch every slice for me. I don't even have to do nothing but be creative on it. Right. I'm like, wow, this is the life. I never even could have imagined it being this tight, you know what I'm saying? Like, really, though. So I'm not hating at all, you know? As far as the music is concerned, there's cats out there that really is getting down on new concepts of music that you couldn't even think of before. Like atmosphere and stuff like that. Yeah. Like, it's been used before, but, like, you don't need melody. You don't need, like, you could have sounds and that could be considered music. It's like it's just a new way of even comprehending what music can be, and like them doors is broke down now, you know, and to the point where it's acceptable now, when before, like, no, that's not music, that's crap, like, it was not accepted. Now, like, a whole lot more is acceptable now, for better or worse. I think it's better. So
you do
what
you like the music nowadays, also it's more broad nowadays.
The possibilities, you know,
I'm not saying it's better necessarily, but it's the possibilities are open now.
All right, coming back to the album, I have some songs where I want to talk to you about. Well, of course, you got the return, the grips back to like the first album. Mm-hmm. It has a very cinematic feel to me. Is that what you thought out to be?
Yeah, when Dan, when Dan and I were talking about, you know, goalposts, I guess, musically, in terms of when we heard what Del was writing and the story he was trying to tell, we were referencing a lot of Morricone stuff, a lot of John Williams stuff, a lot of.
I could hear it in the sound, some tracks, really, like the Morricone you said.
Yeah, we wanted that sort of propulsive, but, you know, bleak, desolate landscape, but with really rich strings that are possibly not in the most comfortable chords, but then within there, there's always the seed of something triumphant on the horizon. I think that's what we liked about that music, you know. And I think
I really got that in what is this loneliness? I really get that feel in that song.
Yeah.
Damon.
Damon is obviously, we've worked with Damon for a long time. He's a phenomenal talent. Yeah.
You have a guy thinking about doing another Gorillaz album with him?
You know what? I was never a part of it, but from the outside looking in.
Yeah, but you had a a big influence. Cause
so what? I mean, that wasn't my doing, though. Like, that was Dan all the way. Okay. All the way. All the way. Like, the song was already done. Dan, I guess, didn't like whoever was on there before and thought I could do a better job. He was basically playing cleanup. He was like, okay, can you, like, whip something up real quick? And I'm like, take me home, dude. I want to go home. He's like, you know you could do it in like 15, 30 minutes, man, tops. Yeah. So he just kept bugging me about it. I'm like, man, all right, dude, I'll do it. So that's how that happened. I wasn't part of the creative. That was after the record was done. So I'll admit that. I was not a part of Gorillaz except for writing that song over. And that was Dan's idea. But for me, looking from the outside, looking in, I'm going to say the corporate body that be kind of took it too far from where it originally was, I think. You know what I mean? That's my personal opinion. Like, it's like everybody is eating off of this. So, like, people are, yeah, we need a new Gorillaz every year. We got to come. It feels like an assembly line to me now. You feel me? That's my personal opinion.
You didn't like the albums after it? The two
albums? I didn't say I didn't necessarily like them, but it seems like there's gears at work there that's like making sure that it happens. You know what I'm saying? Okay. Like, it's not, you know what I'm saying? Like, I would say they should do a new album together that's even better than Gorillaz. Like, why should it be Gorillaz? They can make a new project that's even better than Gorillaz. Why come out with Super Mario Brothers every time you come out with this system? I'm tired of Super Mario Brothers. I know Shigeru Miyamoto could come up with a new game that's even better than Super Mario Brothers, but they gotta cling to that Super Mario Brothers. That's their.
Yeah, that's because that's what sells.
That's what they think sells. You know what I'm saying? But that started from somewhere too. Be brave, make some new shit up. Or is that the only idea you have? That's what a consumer like me is looking at it like, oh, this again? And I know I'm not the only one like that. You know, that's why I was worried about Deltron, because I'm one of them people that would have been like, whatever, dude. You know what I'm saying? I would be giving people a hard time, like, whatever, it better be good, too.
Is that also a reason why it took a long time?
Yeah, because I wanted to make sure there was no holes. I wanted to make sure that everything was covered before I put my neck out there like that. You know what I mean? I wanted people to be satisfied because I know how I am as a consumer. I'm open, but like, oh, it's part two? Okay, you just want some money. That's what I would have thought of right off the back. Okay, you got to bring it back again. That's just how I feel. Like, most people do it for that reason.
Yeah, true. But you guys didn't, because you made a good product now.
I felt like there was something else that could have been added. Like, once people came back to me and told me what they seen, I was like, okay, it's bigger than what I thought it was. Basically, I thought it was just, really, I didn't put no thought behind it. When Dan picked it up and was like, okay, I'll try this. We can put this out. I didn't expect that. Like, Dom came back at me and was like, okay, I told Dom my idea, and he went and was talking to Dan about it, and then Dom came and told me, yeah, Dan was telling him about your idea, and he was like, he was interested, so if you want to try to make that a go, he's with it. Yeah. So, like, I didn't know about that until he came back and told me. Like, that was something he went and told him on his own because he thought the idea was dope, but it was just a hobby for me.
Yeah, I mean, when we did the first one, we weren't doing it for money motivations at all. We just wanted to make the record we wanted to make. And with Event 2, it was that too. After 10 years of us doing other projects and learning and, you know, doing film scores and producing rock bands, you know, in Dan's case, or for me, you know, same thing. We're all kind of 10 years more evolved in each of our crafts. And it was that time where it was like, you know, it'd be fun to do another Deltron record now that we're 10 years better, each of us. And to combine that energy and you know, really put some work into something. That's what happened here. You know, so, I mean, when it's sort of false to think that it took 12 years to complete. I think really it was more like 6 to 8 months that we spent.
Well, my part took like about a week to record.
Really? To record, not to write.
To write, okay, it took like years to come up with the shit that was, I felt good enough.
Yeah.
And to really have, okay, I'm sure I want to go this way. Like, that took a while too. Because I wasn't going to just throw anything out, it's going to be okay. I'm like, nah, let me see if this is the way I want to present myself and come out. Because once it's out, that's it.
Yeah.
So I had to think it through, like, is this the way I want it? And like I said, I scaled back after a while, like, okay, you going too far. You better go back to that first formula that you had and then work off that, because you're going to be doing all this for nothing. And people were like, okay, you tap dance and do it. No, I don't like it. Whatever, it's bullshit. I don't like it. I don't care how hard you worked on it. I don't like it. So I was like, okay, let me go back to this formula and then work and add to that, instead of trying to reshape the wheel or whatever. You know, the wheel already made, it worked fine.
And of course, I can imagine you have to get in a certain mode to do this character.
That's what I'm saying. They take a certain mode. I'm not even a big sci-fi fan, to tell you the truth.
Oh, really?
I'm not no Trekkie. I'm not no Star Wars nut. You know what I'm saying? Far from it, actually. I like anime and stuff like that, manga, you know, things that have to do with giant robots like Transformers. But like, even that was something that I wasn't immersed in at the time. I was immersed in learning music. Yeah. Like that replaced video games and, you know, cartoons for a long time. Like, replaced it. So like, that was the world I was in, and dealing with street shit, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Broads trying to frame me and all this other stupid shit, all violence and all this crime and shit going on around me that I'm trying to keep out of. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's where my focus was, trying to keep myself out of that.
Is this project then some sort of an escapism for you guys?
I looked at it like, that's what people want. You know what I mean? Because I got my other albums, and some people could relate to my albums, but a lot of people was like, I don't want reality. I want Deltron. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, okay. They don't want this, you know what I'm saying? Like, maybe people around me might be able to relate to hoes and people trying to frame you and people shooting at you and shit like that. Maybe people around me in my neighborhood can relate to that. But these other people was like, I don't want that. I'm tired of hearing that. I can't relate to that. I want Deltron. That's my hope. I don't want to hear about frustrating now. I want to hear something that got hope. So I was like, okay. And you know what? I'm kind of bored with that too. You know what I'm saying? Like, I want something more abstract to myself. You know what I'm saying? I'm tired of writing about this bitch or whatever. You feel me?
Yeah.
So yeah, it was definitely an escapism of sorts. Yeah.
Another track that really caught my ear was "Talent Supersedes." I really like the one lyric that caught me was the opening of verse two. The humanoid race feels that they should rule the whole space-time continuum. Could you elaborate on that?
It is what it is. Let me look at it. I'll elaborate if
yeah,
I can.
Yeah, my English isn't written down so good, but
I could get it. Where is it? Right here. Where?
And then
okay. The humanoid race feels that they should rule the whole space. Yeah, there you go. That's not true. I mean, we like basically are living creatures like every other living creature on the planet, but we don't respect the other living creatures. Like, we don't even respect ourselves, so that's probably why we don't respect the other creatures, because we don't even respect our damn self. We be fighting each other, trying to kill each other and all this other shit. We do that to ourselves, so of course we don't respect no other creature, but we feel like we're the top of the food chain and the others are beneath us, and it should be that way. God made us that way. We're the greatest. We actually think it probably ain't nobody else in the galaxy that's like it. We're the smartest motherfuckers in the whole galaxy. You know what I'm saying? Like, we're the top.
So if that's true, how real could a real Deltron world be? So it can happen in the future, I guess.
I mean, that's the way it is now. I mean, like, what I'm talking about is that's how people feel now. And I'm talking about people that, you know, of course there's people that might be on a different wavelength, or, you know, their brain frequency is operating at a more feverish pitch or whatever. But like, most people, they think that the world center around whatever they're thinking about, whatever fucking shit is on their mind, that's all there is. You know what I'm saying? And the more simple-minded a person is, the more it get down to that. Like, if you think about somebody that's racist, they think, like, white people are the center of the universe, and that's it. Anybody, if you are any other color, you are a baboon or something. Like, you shouldn't even be allowed to, like, you're like an animal, like the other dogs or whatever. Like, you just grouped along with them. We are the true whatever. But that's so simple, my, like, why do you think that way? Because we're white? You're not even white, though. You know what I'm saying? Well, I am white. No, you're not white. That's not what your race is. They're not called white. What are you talking about? What is white? What is black? That's something that's some concept motherfuckers made up just to be able to label shit. But so you see what I'm saying? The shit is simple-minded. But that's what I meant by that. You know what I mean? Like, people's minds is just so focused on dumb shit when we could do such great, bigger things if we just got together collectively and worked as a unit. You know what I mean? Which I'm not saying doesn't happen. It happens definitely, or else we wouldn't have shit, actually.
How do you reflect on Mandela's death, then? How do you saw him?
How did I see him?
What an influence did he have?
You know what? Growing up in, like, the Public Enemy era and stuff like that, like the late 80s, you know, early 90s, like the whole apartheid thing, you know what I'm saying? That shit was serious, you know what I mean? It's still serious over there, really, to tell you the truth. It ain't like it's hella been solved. But that little thing, it opened up a lot. Because before then, it was a fool, you know what I mean? So that's what that means to me, you know what I mean? And he's gone, like, you know, we gonna be gone too, so. So you could remember the things that he did to open up some of this stuff so that people could be a little bit more freer and be able to think a little bit more as a unit, you know what I'm saying, instead of so separative. Because that's really what it was about, people just separating themselves, like, no, we're the same thing I was talking about, you know?
Also, another thing on the song, and that's more your craft, is I really like the scratches, and I think that's one thing that I myself as a listener is missing in nowadays is hip hop. Is the scratching? It seems almost gone.
Say it again. Oh, the scratch. Yeah, yeah.
Is that right? I don't know. to me, it's just my instrument. Yeah. It's my main instrument. I started on piano, but when it comes time to do stuff on Deltron, yeah, that's my duty, you know, make sure that part of it, the turntables are represented, but to find a way to twist it to harmonize with what's going on, you know, both musically and narrative.
But how you look at hip hop now? Because it used to be much bigger turntablism than it is. I mean, you still got the competitions. But on the CDs, on the albums.
You know what? I think it's more about if you a DJ, it's like you a music historian or something. Like, you have a great amount of knowledge about music. You know what I'm saying? You like a tastemaker of sorts. You know what I'm saying? You know how shit sound, what good stuff is. You know, you have these reference points. So more than just him scratching and doing that shit on the record, he just brought his wealth of knowledge about shit to the table, to the project. You know, if we needed this kind of sound, he knew where to get it from. Because that's what he fucked with all day. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? I mean, he's so good at being a DJ that he can manipulate the turntable to do whatever he probably wanted to. Too, but like sound just in general, he knows, you know what I mean?
And especially with Deltron, it was a lot of stuff that, you know, I was digging for, was just trying to find things that could thread some of these concepts and some of the story that Del had through the choruses, you know? If he needed to take a break for the choruses, and when something had to come in, but still run, you know, tie the story into the next verse somehow. Even if it's just, you know, a few words from some, you know, space transmission or whatever it is, you know, to just help set the tone for what that track was about, you know. So sometimes it's a narrative thing, sometimes it's a musical thing, sometimes it's a percussive thing, you know.
For example, like samples, do you also do the digging or
To be honest, a lot of the stuff that we did on this record was create, like, custom plates, like, so we record, you know, make a guitar just feed back through a tape echo and just have it oscillate and just some really spacey noise.
Yeah.
Then cut that onto vinyl because I have a record cutter.
Sound design, basically.
So then cut it back onto vinyl, and once it's on vinyl, then you can multiply that by all the things you can scratch with. So it was really to create these almost like custom, you know, sound. It's almost like
it gives a great dimension.
Yeah, I mean, for me, is approaching it almost like you're fashioning your own bow for a violin, or you're like, I'm not saying you have to go that deep if you're a DJ, but for me, I'm a bit of a nerd, so yeah, I went that far. You know what I mean? Where it's almost like, it's like if you can make a salad and be like, okay, I'm gonna make a salad,
you know, I can go to the grocery store and buy some stuff, or I'm going to make a salad. Like, no, I'm going to actually go plant my own tomatoes. You know, that's how far it went to a molecular level on some of the sounds on Deltron, which is a really kind of crazy process and a lot of time that adds to the production time. But in the end, it's still like, no, then we know that this is just going to have this different life to it, you know, different original sound to it, hopefully, you know.
The last track on the album, Do You Remember? It feels very soulful, nostalgic. Why end with a relaxer, nostalgic tune?
That was Dan's suggestion, or that was Dan's planning, and I think he made a wise decision. He in the sequence that he gave me the beats or whatever, that wasn't like the last beat he gave me or nothing like that. So that wasn't the reason, you know what I mean? But he definitely had a definite idea for that music. It already had a chorus probably, or he had the chorus. So he's like, try to write something along the lines of this. And he told me, and then I just did what he wanted me to do, basically. You know what I mean? He had the idea, he had the concept, he had the music. He just needed me to put the words there. And he had, I mean, to the bar length, you know what I'm saying? I was like, okay, great. You know what I mean? So that's how that worked. I mean, I guess it captures what it needed to capture, but that's he's a producer, so that's what he thought it should end up to. Maybe he thought the other songs was like, whatever, but he wanted it to come to some kind of point where there's some kind of resolution, probably. If it was me, I probably would have left it unresolved because I like it better that way. Nah, just stay in space forever. You know what I'm saying? Be upset forever. But like, you know, I guess as a producer, you want it to be some kind of resolution at the end. So when people are finished, yeah, you know, they feel like, oh, okay, we're done. That was tight.
Yeah, true.
You know?
What's next for Deltron?
More shows.
Definitely.
And after the shows, another album, or do you don't plan ahead that the fuck?
Y'all buy the shit, then yeah. if you don't buy it, why should we make another record for you to be like, you know, that wasn't as good as part two. That wasn't it. Just sit up and critique the shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, if you want us to come out with another Deltron, show your support by going and buying this Deltron, and then we'll consider it. But like I said before, I love working with these dudes, you know what I'm saying? The tour's been great. Even the people that's in the band, I love working with them too. I wouldn't mind working on something new that's better than Deltron. And it could be futuristic too, but it, you know what I'm saying? Something new that's even better than Deltron. You know what I mean? Like, you don't even know what it is yet. It could be, damn, ooh. You know what I mean? So I always want to work with them in some capacity. It might not be Deltron, but hey, you didn't know Deltron was Deltron either until it came out. And I'm just kidding about buying. You buy it if you want to, you know what I mean? I'm not trying to give people no ultimatum, man. I'm kidding about it.
Yeah, it's like a telethon. Yeah. We got to get to this many sales and we're going to turn the studio back on.
All right, last question. One for both of you. Could you name one of your favorite albums? And why?
Anytime, doesn't matter if it's hip hop or whatever.
I'll let you go first.
Lady in Satin, Billie Holiday. That was a record that a lot of people couldn't deal with because it was one of her last records. It was her favorite record. It was the first time she got to pick the songs.
Yeah.
And then she found Ray Ellis to arrange for her because she really liked the version of a song. And but her voice was completely thrashed by then. You know, she had been in and out of rehab. It was like at the end of her career. But it's probably some of the most heartfelt singing that you could possibly hear. You know what I mean?
Man, how can I top that? I was playing. Boosie Collins' first album. I think that's called?
He's on the bike.
Yeah, he's on the bike coming out.
Yeah.
That's the one with a psychotic bump school on it.
Yeah, and also like the one that got sampled by Eazy-E.
Yeah, I like all of them, but psychotic bump school, when I first heard that, and he just went boom.
Yeah.
Boom. Boom. I was like, damn, I would have never did that. It's so simple, but that's the super slap. That was like a Future slap to me. And he was like the future of funk. Like, he was the youngest. He was coming out with a new brand of funk. And that nothing on that album is weak. None of it is weak. It's all hella tight.
I know, I got it at home, so.
So no, you know what? Let me take that back. Ultra Wave is dope, too. That was like his first solo album, I think. Ultra Wave. That's the super slap, too. But Boosie Collins, I think, would have to be one. You know what? Hold up. Trumbibulation.
From Parliament.
Mm-hmm.
With the elephant nose.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't like
that
album.
It is that album, but I think it's good.
It's hella tight.
Yeah.
Cube put me up on that album. Cube let me hear that, because he was like, man, you ain't up on this slap. And I was like, damn, what the fuck is this? I've never seen that one before. I thought I'd seen them all. That's where they got Humpty Dance from.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. Dun, 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 dun. Ooh, baby. Yep. Yeah, that's the fucking slap. Man, oh my God, that album is so slapping. It was crazy, though, so that's why I think a lot of people's like, they're too far out, man. No, 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 okay. Okay, Sweatband. Sweatband and Godmama. Because them two albums came out like, kind of like early 80s, and like people kind of thought that the funk was over or whatever. Them two albums are so slapping, especially Sweatband. Sweatband was like a secret project, I guess, that Bootsy had produced. Basically came out on Uncle Jam's Army, you know, on a
label.
Yeah, you feel me? So it was kind of under the radar, but that album is so goddamn slamming. Damn.